With this, I'd like to introduce Dr. Riley Moynes. Do you want to retire or do you want to rewire? Because what Riley is going to talk to us about today, based on his experience, he's a very successful entrepreneur, teacher. He has a track record that's 100 miles long. I'd go on for an hour about it, and he will touch on that today. But he has studied this phase of our lives. He studied the psychology. He studied many people that have gone through this phase. And he's discovered that rewiring is a heck of a lot better than retiring. So without further ado, can I introduce Dr. Riley Moynes?
Thanks, sir. Thank you, Harry. Thank you for being here, folks. Much appreciated. I hope you're going to enjoy it. I'm looking forward to it. We're going to spend some time together. Let me begin, if I may, by asking, I'm supposed to stay away from that speaker. How many of you are in what you would call retirement mode? You are retired. Yep. Sammy? Okay. Well, for people who are not quite there as yet, my hope is that our presentation today and the book that you'll be receiving a copy of at the end will give you kind of a heads up as to the kinds of things that you can expect to happen. If you are in what you would call retirement mode or retirement phase, I'm hoping that our discussion today will kind of give you some framework that can help it make more sense to you than it might have otherwise. I just wish, for example, that I knew then what I know now about these phases. It would have made it much, much easier for me than I found it. So we're going to start then by quoting Warren Buffett. And Warren says, everyone says you've got to get ready financially. No, you've got to get ready psychologically. Now, of course, he doesn't mean that you don't have to worry about the financial side of it. And of course, you do. And we're assuming, both in our presentation here today and in the book, that you have a reasonably stable financial situation. And there is also an assumption that you are enjoying reasonable health. Because I appreciate that without either of those or both of those, retirement looks very different than it does if you are lucky enough to have stability on both of those sides. But the point is that he understood that the biggest challenge for him and for many other people is the psychological challenge, because you don't know what to expect. And my experience in the financial services industry is that as people help you prepare for retirement, the focus is on the investments, and it's on the estate considerations, and it's on the insurance, and all of those are important, but there's very little said or discussed about the psychological side of it. It's kind of the elephant in the room that isn't discussed. And that's why I found it such an interesting and challenging project for me to undertake. Let's talk a little bit about background, first of all. And you know much of this stuff, but it does help to kind of set the stage, I think. First baby boomers hit retirement age in 2011. Boomers now represent about 27% of the population, but only 18 to 20% of us have reached age 65. The peak doesn't come for another 10 years. So we are facing a retirement landslide, a tsunami of retirement over the next 10 to 15 years. 10,000 North Americans will retire today and tomorrow and the next day and the next day for the next 10 to 15 years. Unprecedented in world history. Boomers over 65 now represent 16% of the population, double what it was in 1971, half of what it will be in the next 10 to 15 years. So a massive shift taking place. Life expectancy, again, you're familiar with a lot of these figures, I'm sure, but not that long ago, in 1950, average life expectancy in Canada was 68 years. Indicating that you could look forward to three delightful years of retirement. And that's where the image I'm convinced of sort of the old image of retirement was, where, you know, the guy retires, the gal retires to the rocking chair and waits for the end. But look what's happened over the last several years. And 2017, these are still the most up-to-date figures that we have from Statistics Canada. Average life expectancy in Canada, 82 years. 17 years of retirement, but the reality is that we're living longer than ever before, and it is not out of the question. In fact, it's quite likely that many of us in this room today will spend up to one-third of our lives in retirement. Imagine that. A third of our lives in retirement, and you compare that to the situation back in 1950 when we could look forward to about 3 years. A few years ago, Prudential Life Insurance Company set up in an open space in Austin, Texas, a great big board. This board is 8 or 10 feet high, and it's 30 or 40 feet long. And as you can see, what they did was to line things up. They put ages across the top. There's retirement age, age 65. And what they asked people to do as people began to gather around and they wondered what was going on here, they distributed little discs, kind of magnetic discs like frisbees. And they asked people to go up to the board and to place a disc on the board to represent the age of the oldest person they know. Well, here's average life expectancy, just over 80. Look where the discs are. 80s, 90s, 100. My mom turned 99 last month. My sister said to her, "You know, Mom, I don't know another person who's 99 years old." And she says, "Well, this is what it looks like." Last Saturday, I checked the Globe and Mail obituaries. They do a big job in the Globe and Mail on obituaries on Saturdays, right? 27 obituaries appeared in the paper that day, and 15 of those 27 obituaries were people who had lived beyond life expectancy. 104, 96, 97, 102, 91, 95, 88, 88, 96. So it's clear that we are living longer, likely longer than we've ever lived before. We need to plan for that. And so the question is, how are we going to spend our one-third of our lives in retirement in a way that's meaningful and productive and that makes us want to get up in the morning? Because we certainly don't want to be in the rocking chair waiting for the end. So that's what this is about. Let me tell you a story, though, how I got involved in this and how I got interested in this. I'm lucky enough to spend some time in the winter in Florida. We live in a golf community in the southwest part of the state. And so golf is a major focus, but lots of other activities. And I'm part of a group that meets every morning, well, every three days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. We get together at 7 o'clock. And our purpose mainly is to put 10,000 steps on our Fitbits, right? That's the deal. An hour, get it in. And then we go to Panera's, have coffee, and tell lies. We talk about a lot of things, sports and politics, although not so much politics the last couple of years, I've noticed. More, you know, movies, books, that kind of thing. And then we got in the habit of making somebody responsible each day for identifying a topic for discussion. So one day, the topic for discussion was, what are the elements of a successful retirement? How's that for 7 o'clock in the morning? So we kicked it around, we chewed on it, you know, and we talked about it for an hour, and then we went to Panera's, and the next day we moved on. But it stuck with me because I was really experiencing some difficulties at the time. There was something missing, I didn't know what it was. I was just kind of messed up a bit. So I decided I was going to do more and look into it more deeply, and my background is in research, so of course I went and did a search of the literature. And to my surprise, frankly, there was really very little on the topic. There was lots about the financial, lots about the estate stuff, but very little about sort of the softer side of it. So I decided that I would talk to as many people as I could who were retired and ask them the question, what are the elements of a successful retirement? I interviewed dozens and dozens of people over a year and a half to 2 years, and I thought I had a pretty good idea of what success looked like in a working career, but when it came to retirement, it was a lot fuzzier for me. But here's what I discovered. And this is the good news. The good news is there is a framework. There's a pattern that can help us to make sense of this, a kind of a guiding blueprint, if you know what you're looking for. So, let me direct your attention to the blue sheet that you have in front of you, called the 99 game. And as it would suggest, there are numbers on that sheet ranging from 1 to 99. What I'm going to ask you to do is to find number 1 and circle it. And then I'm going to ask you in the next 30 seconds to find number 2 and then number 3 and number 4 and to go as high as you can in order over the next 30 seconds. Yes, sir, you have a question first? Nope, nope, okay, thought you did. So, ready, set, go. Okay, pens down, as Alex says. Okay, show of hands, 99. 50, who got to 50? 40, 30, 20. We're not gonna go any further. We're not trying to embarrass anybody here, but okay, so it was a jumble, and we didn't do all that well. Let me give you some information that might be helpful, or some guidelines. Let me ask you to draw a line down the middle of the page, approximately, if you would, a vertical line, and also a horizontal line across about the middle of the page, so you've got four more or less equidistant quarters, sections. And let me tell you as well, if it hasn't clicked in quite as yet, that number 1 is located in the top right hand column, number 2 is in the top left, number 3 is in the bottom left, number 4 is in the bottom right, and so on. So, with this new information, let's take another 30 seconds, pick up where you left off at number 3 or 4 or whatever it was. And let's see how much further we can get in the next 30 seconds with this newfound information. Go. Stop. How many got further the second time than the first time? Yes, everybody did. And how do you account for that?
Knowledge of a pattern.
Yeah. You knew what you were looking for, right? Makes things easier. Well, that's what I'm hoping that we're going to be able to provide you today. Knowledge of a pattern, help you to figure out what you're looking for, and it will help it to make more sense for you as we press on. So, when we're finished in the next 30 minutes or so, you are going to know what the four phases of retirement are. If you are retired, you will know which phase you are in currently. And you're going to be given four tools that will help you to get to phase 4 if you decide that's where you'd like to be. And I urge you to decide that's where you'd like to be. That's where it's at, in my opinion. But you will see, and you'll be the judge of that. All right? So let's start. Phase 1. Phase 1 is what I call the vacation phase. It's just exactly what it says. It generally lasts 1 to 3 years. It can vary, of course, from person to person, but that's what I've discovered in my interviews and research. It tends to be a time when we have an opportunity to check off a lot of the bucket list things that we had been developing over a number of years previously, but either didn't have time or didn't have the resources to be able to accomplish. Lifelong dreams, whatever they might be, often it involves travel or working on the golf game or the tennis game or the pickleball game or whatever it is. Often involves a new car, a new vehicle, sports car often, or a sailboat, perhaps something like that. Often includes purchase of a place in a warmer climate. That's all typical of phase one vacation type activities. And what we appreciate most about phase one in many situations is that there's no set routine. You know, our lives have been dominated and determined by routines for as long as we can remember. And at this phase of our lives, it's just like being on a holiday. You get up when you want, you go to bed when you want, you do what you want, when you want. There's something liberating about it, and most of us really, really appreciate that. But what I've also discovered is that too much of a good thing can be kind of too much of a good thing. It's too much. And many of us get tired of vacation. And at that point, what we discover is that it's no longer vacation, but we're back to reality. And the reality that faces us when we're finished the vacation phase is, well, it's a reality that has been described by some people as a plunge into the abyss of insignificance. But we know for sure that this drop from the top is one of life's top 10 traumas. It has significant effects on people. You see, we've spent the first 20 years or so of our lives being conditioned and being made ready to be productive citizens, right? We've been taught, we've been educated, we've been told to say please and thank you and to show up on time, and we're prepared to be launched into a working career, which then consumes quite possibly the next 40 or so years of our lives, dominated by restrictions and by routines. We learn some of the rules, but it's pretty constrained. We may have some success, we may climb a ladder, we may be responsible for some budget or for some personnel, but that's what our life is like for a long time. And then one day, whether it's our decision or somebody else's decision, it's over. It's just plain over. And now we face what could be a third of our lives, could well be 30 years of our lives, moving into a situation in which there are basically no rules, and it's an entirely new world for us. And after the vacation phase, this reality hits us hard. Now we're in phase two. In phase two, we are feeling loss, and we are feeling lost. Associated with this phase are five significant and almost unavoidable losses. We lose the structure of our lives. We rail against it. We're not happy necessarily that we've got this routine that we have to adhere to, but when we don't have it, we miss it. We are beings. We are creatures of routine. We need a routine. It's just better if it's our routine than somebody else's. But when there's no routine, it's a significant loss. No structure equals loss. Many of us, males in particular, identify themselves with their calling, with their career, with their jobs. And many people who are retired still identify themselves as, you know, I was an accountant, I was a teacher, I was this, I was that. But you're not anymore. But we identify with that. And when that identity is taken away from us, that's another significant loss I have found. Relationships. In many situations, people who are work colleagues become friends. And all of a sudden, when we leave and they carry on, those relationships are, if not broken, they're just not the same. And yes, you can go back for coffee with the guys or the gals every month or so and chew the fat, but the truth is, they're still there, they've carried on, and you're the fifth wheel, and you know it, you feel it. And you don't do that very often. So these relationships are lost as well, or at least injured. A sense of purpose. Many of us draw that sense of purpose from our profession, our calling, whatever it might be. It's why we get up in the morning. It's important to us. We're deeply devoted to that cause. And when we lose that purpose, that's another significant loss. And finally, loss of power. In some cases, we've taken on some responsibilities, right? We may have some budgetary or some personnel responsibilities. And that brings with it a sense of power. You know, we're seen as people who can get things done, or rainmakers, or whatever the term you might use, but that's gone. And now we're just another guy or another gal on the street. Simultaneously, I mean, it would be bad enough if these things were imposed upon us one at a time. But in phase two, they all come at the same time. Bam, 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 like punches to the face. Almost no one avoids those. Almost everybody experiences at least, well, I'm going to say all of them, some of them less severe than others. But these are things that happen to us almost at the same time. In phase two, there is a much greater risk of depression. The Mayo Clinic has indicated that there is a 40% likelihood that a retiree will experience signs of clinical depression. 40% likelihood. Physical decline, mental decline, divorce. In North America, look at this. Divorces among people over 50 have doubled, and over 65 have tripled since 1990. I mean, it has huge effects. The result can make us feel like this. We've been hit by a bus. We're struggling. We're suffering, in many cases, severely. Highest rate of suicide in North America today, men over 75. This is phase two at its full-blown worst. No wonder we feel like we've been hit by a bus. People struggle, because it's true. Before we can achieve some of the good things that can be ahead of us in phase three or four, we are going to experience some of this stuff. We're going to experience fear and anxiety and uncertainty. It's absolutely the case. I know it from my own experience. I know it from my interview experience. I know it from the research. It's a simple fact. And it's made worse, if possible, by the fact there's another study that I came across at the University of Greenwich in England a couple of years ago. And they indicated that it often happens that there is a later life crisis precipitated, not necessarily by retirement, although that's part of it, but what happens to so many of us during this period of our lives, in our 60s or 70s, is that in addition to retirement, there's injury or there's illness, either to ourselves or to someone else. We end up perhaps having to care for a loved one, or there's the loss of a loved one. So it's not just retirement, but some of these other things that seem to happen in life around that time can make this period of our lives extremely, extremely difficult. It seems to be just the way it is. Because it's really only, I think, when we suffer these five losses that we begin to ponder about what's really important about our lives. It's almost like an addict who has to hit bottom before they consider making changes. A scary time for many, many people. But finally, most of us come to grips with the fact that I don't want to go on like this. I don't want to live the rest of my life like this. I've got quite likely a third of my life to live. And I begin to ask, what can I do? What can I do that can make me feel worthwhile again? What can be meaningful for me? What can I get involved with where I can sense some achievement or perhaps even some giving back? And when that happens, in the rehab phase, we are in phase three. You know we're in phase three when we begin to ask, how can we still contribute? We have to understand that it may well involve false starts. I'll share a couple of personal examples in just a moment. But it's unlikely that we sort of get a bright idea and, that's what I'm going to throw myself into. It just doesn't seem to work like that in most situations. Most of us tend to choose initiatives based on our interests or our experiences, perhaps, or just plain inquisitiveness. I interviewed one lady who she said she didn't have a musical bone in her body, and she decided that she was going to learn to play the violin. And she just threw herself into it. That was the inquisitiveness part, because she certainly had no experience in that area. Most people seem to link to something that has given them some interest in the past or based on some experience. But it's important to realize that we have to go back to the drawing board when it doesn't work out the first time, and it will be unlikely that it will work out for the first time. I've got a couple of classic failures to share with you. These are just two of many. I don't know whether you might be familiar with the First Tee. First Tee is a youth development program in the U.S. It is sponsored by the Professional Golfers Association and the Ladies Professional Golf Association, the Masters Tournament. They all believe that the First Tee is a useful youth development program. There are two of them in Canada, one in Montreal and one in Vancouver, and I had this brilliant idea that there should be one in the Toronto area and that I would take care of that. I would make that happen. So I began to look at what was involved, and to make a long story short, and it was about a two-year venture. What finally happened was that the organization, now referred to as Golf Canada, decided that they didn't really need the First Tee. They had their own program that they thought was every bit as good, and I think they're delusional in that. But that was their position, and the First Tee said to me, Riley, we would love to be in Toronto, but we're not going to fight with Golf Canada. We're busy enough developing it here in the States. So that one fizzled. Another great idea I had, my background started in education, and there's a group in the U.S. called Watchdogs, Dads of Great Students. And the idea there was that they were looking, particularly in elementary schools, for an increased male presence. Help to stop bullying, perhaps provide some mentorship, some role modeling kind of thing. Very popular in the United States. And I thought, well, there's certainly a place for that kind of thing here as well. Same kind of situation, take some time to look at it. In the end, they just decided that they were busy enough in the U.S., they didn't have the bandwidth, was the term that they used, to bother helping us here in Canada. So those were big failures. On the other hand, I've had some successes as well, and I'm really focused on these two right now. You may be familiar with Probus, yeah? Probus group for semi-retired, retired folks that provides speakers on every occasion and all kinds of other activities. Get connected, stay connected is the idea. So we've just launched one here in Richmond Hill, actually. 200,000 people in Richmond Hill, no Probus program. 200,000 people in Burlington, 6 Probus clubs. So we're just getting launched here in the next couple of weeks here in Probus. And also Water Ambassadors of Canada is a cause that I've become involved with. Water Ambassadors of Canada know that contaminated water is the world's biggest cause of disease and death, and probably the easiest to fix. They know that 6,000 children a day die of contaminated water. So I'm going to see if I can do something about that. So we're off on running there. The point of it is, there are ways that you have to look at some ideas. Some of them will work, some of them will not. But at some point, many people break through to phase four. And phase four is what I call the reinvent and repurpose phase. That's the phase where you finally get it, where something appeals to you, something resonates with you, and you decide, it may not be just one thing, it may be two or three things, but things that you want to make a difference, you want to make a contribution to and make a difference. Not everyone gets there. I estimate, not a scientifically researched conclusion. My belief, based on my experience with interviews, is that about half of retirees get to phase four. Only half. But those who do are among the happiest people I have ever seen. Phase four does something for us that is exciting to watch. But we don't get there without some effort. Breakthrough to phase four requires asking some questions, some self-analysis, and frankly, we don't spend a lot of time on self-analysis in most situations. But we first of all, of course, need to know, if I'm retired, what phase am I in now? You know, we need to know where we are before we know where we're going. But even more importantly, like, what am I here for? Why am I here? What's my job? And my experience is that it almost always involves service of some sort. Volunteer service, perhaps being paid for services that you provide, but it almost always involves service to others. Winston Churchill, many great lines, but one of the ones I like best, we make a living by what we get. We make a life by what we give. Here's an example. A bunch of guys met for breakfast every Saturday morning, and as far as they were concerned, their discussions were, you know, they were saving the world. But they kind of got bored with saving the world every week. And one of them had an idea that said, you know what I'm going to do? We're going to get ourselves a little tent, and we're going to get ourselves a little table down at the farmer's market, and we're going to dispense advice. It'll be free advice, probably bad advice, but it's free. So they've been doing this for about 6 months now, and some of the key questions. Why does my cat pee on everything in the house? These are some of the questions that they're asked. Where can I find someone to love? Somebody said, are you guys qualified to do this? He said, of course not, but neither is Ann Landers. We're just having fun. Well, here's what's happened. They have become the most popular tent in the farmer's market. And you know what they're doing now? They've now started a weekly podcast where they answer the questions that people have been asking. And they think they're providing a tremendous service. One's a former teacher, this gal is a journalist. Another one owned the deli where they used to meet. Then they show up there, and there's one guy who is apparently an old coot in training, but he's not old enough to qualify as an old coot as yet. So they're just sort of teaching him the ropes of this sort of thing. So this is the kind of thing that can be done. Not very elevated, perhaps, not all that sophisticated, but they are the most popular tent. I mentioned that as we started that we were going to provide you with four tools that can help you to get to phase four if you decide that you'd like to be there. I hope you understand now why I believe that's to be aspired to. Just before we have a look at the sheet, let me just refer briefly here to the chart. I'm sure that there are some things that you do, and there are certainly things that I do, a wide variety of things, a huge number of things, at which I am completely and happily incompetent. Couldn't care less. Tons of them. There is a smaller number of things that I consider that I do competently. In a pinch, I can barbecue a hamburger. There is a smaller number of things that I do, in my opinion, really very well. And there is even a smaller number of things that I love to do and do superbly well, and so it is for you. I call this bullseye your unique ability. You may have more than one of them, but I believe that in order for you to decide how you might want to throw yourselves into something in phase four, it's important to know where you can probably get the most leverage and bring the most to bear. So have a look, if you would, at the second sheet that's there. It's called tool number one, my unique ability. Your unique ability can be described as things that you love to do, things that you do superbly well, and things that have brought success in the past. You love to do it, you do it extremely well, and it has contributed to success in the past. So we're going to take a few moments, just a few here. This is kind of a primer to give you a chance, if you've not done so previously, to just make a list of some of the things that you love to do, that you do extremely well, and that have contributed to success for you in the past. No time for modesty. We have lots more paper if required. So some of the strengths that you're listing can be used at some point, maybe today, maybe not today, to put into one sentence your unique ability. It's powerful to be able to express this unique ability in one sentence. Another minute or so, and we'll press on. So I'm not going to embarrass anybody by asking them to kind of blurt out what it is that's your unique ability, but let me ask this question if I can. Are you able to express your unique ability in one sentence? Yes? Was that a yes? Good for you. Good. It's powerful to be able to do so. It really helps you to focus on areas that you can get involved with. I believe that my unique ability is the ability to take information that may at first glance appear to be complicated, confusing, and difficult to understand, and to synthesize it, to boil it down, and to present it in a way that is easier for people to understand. That, I'm sure, comes at least in part from a background in education. But I believe that that's my unique ability, and that's been really helpful for me in deciding how I wanted to express that unique ability at this phase of my life. Okay. The second thing, second tool, things we need to think about for a moment, are thinking back on your life, and this is tool number two, high points. I'm going to ask you to consider for a couple of moments, and I've shown it here kind of chronologically, but don't let that kind of get in the way of your thinking process. The question is, what are some of the things that have given you the greatest satisfaction? Some of the achievements that have, in the past, in your life, given you some of the greatest sense of achievement? What did you find that was highly gratifying, either in a working career or in your past? And what were you doing during times when you were experiencing real success? So we're talking about high points, we're talking about successes, wins that you've experienced in the past. And you'll see in a moment, I think, why it's important to give some consideration to that. So again, let's take just a couple of minutes. Again, it's a primer. And just kind of review and make a quick note that will... Yeah, as I said, I've set it up chronologically. Yes, if that makes it easier for you to organize it, fine. But as I say, don't let that get in the way. Just think of maybe the top 10 would be another way to go about it. But yeah. High points. Another minute, and we'll press on. Ten more seconds on this one. Okay. There is no tool number three. If you've been worrying about not finding it. What I'm going to ask you to do here is to place tool number one on the left side and tool number two on the right side in front of you so you can see them simultaneously. And look for overlaps. Look for overlaps. It shouldn't be surprising, should it, that some of your strengths and abilities and things that have led to success have also led to high points in your career. So, in one way or another, in some way that kind of makes sense to you, physically draw a link between the connections that you see. Maybe just, you know, circle both parts, link them together. But just be aware of the fact that there's a connection between these two. And just draw those connections. Thank you. So when we can isolate them and connect them, we're getting very close to where we want to be. And where we want to believe, I would submit, is here. When we put together the things about which we are really excited, really passionate, when we combine those with some things that represent our strengths, that have led to success in the past, and we combine that with a desire that I have found over and over and over again in these interviews, is that it almost always comes out, perhaps in different words or phrases, but everybody wants to make a difference, a positive difference of some sort. It seems to be ingrained in us. You know, Steve Jobs talked about making a dent in the universe. Well, he probably did. He made a pretty darn big dent in the universe, and most of us aren't probably destined to have that kind of impact. But deep down, it just seems that we all want to do something that makes a difference, a positive difference. And so my belief is that at the point where these three overlap, that relatively small spot, that's your sweet spot. That's where everything is brought together and really just speaks to you and what you need and want to do going forward. Because that sweet spot, I think, is really another way of saying what's really, really important to you. Now, there was an interesting study done by Harvard University, a 20-year study involving 15,000 retirees. And what they discovered was the unhappiest retirees of all had not gone on to do anything beyond pleasing themselves. That's phase one. Right? That's all about me. That's my bucket list. That's me having fun, which is fine for a period of time. But the unhappiest retirees in this 20-year study had not gone on to do anything productive beyond pleasing themselves. Happiness comes from doing something that helps others. It seems to be ingrained in us. Most of us, I think you'd agree, need to find activities that are meaningful for us and that give us a sense of purpose. And whatever that looks like, it'll be hugely different for different people, of course. But that seems to be one of the driving forces. And so I'm urging that you consider harnessing that in this phase of your life, in phase four, if you get to phase four, if you decide you want to be in phase four, gives a tremendous sense. Anytime you use your God-given abilities to help others, you're fulfilling your calling. You're doing what you were put here to do. And in this phase of your life, we have the opportunity to do that, perhaps in a way that we never did in the past. So remember, you're not alone in this transition. A number of people that I spoke to had this impression that it's only me who's experiencing these terrible things in phase two. No, 10,000 people are retiring every day, a tsunami, and people are experiencing this transition along with you. But the good news is we have more options to consider and probably longer to activate or to act upon those options than ever before, because we're likely going to spend a third of our lives in retirement, and we want it to be productive. So this great opportunity is presented to combine our strengths, the things that are important to us, the things that are meaningful to us, to kind of be the change that we would like to see, as Mahatma Gandhi expressed it. Let me give you my favorite example. This is my friend Bill He lives in our golf community in Florida. Bill had this idea that we can be more than a golf community. And his idea was that there is a tremendous resource in our community. We've got about 1,000 doors, as they call it. He believed that there are people in that community who have had tremendous success in the past. And furthermore, he believed that if they were called upon and if they were asked to volunteer to share some of their experiences and skills, they would do so. They would do so. So he began an organization, or at least a project called iLife. And Bill is holding up last year's iLife catalog. This is this year's iLife catalog. But let me give you a little bit of background on this one. He started this project in 2011. He had this idea in 2011. And he approached 9 people in our community who he knew had skills. One of them was an artist. One of them was good at bridge and was interested in teaching bridge. Things like that. Bill himself is knowledgeable and interested in iPhones, iPads, all that kind of stuff. And he knew darn well that many of the folks in our community have been given new iPhones and iPads by their children for Christmas and didn't know how to turn the darn thing on. So he was going to offer some suggestions to how you could make best use of this. So there were 9 programs in the first year, and there were 210 registrations. It was all offered free to people in the community. The volunteers provided it free. Those who came, free. 210. Next year, it mushroomed from 9 offerings to 45 offerings. And from 210 registrations to 442. He knew he was on to something. Next year, 72 offerings, up from 45. 694 participants, up from 442 the previous year. And so on. 2016, 115 offerings, 1,879 participants. And in this particular catalog, there are 99 offerings. They're coming to an end just about now as things wind down in Florida. So we've gone from a little 8x10 black and white thing that said, come and do this, and now we've got a 30 or 40 page glossy brochure with over 99 offerings and over 2,000 participants. I mean, that's phase four. That is such a classic story of phase four. And he said, all I had to do was ask. I knew people would do it, and they did. And this is the magic. I love this part of it. Because you remember back in phase two, we talked about all the 5 losses? Well, in phase four, everything turns around. Bill has a new structure for his life. He was a dentist. He imposed pain for 40 years on people. And this is a new structure for him. I mean, he's so thrilled with the success of it, and his life is organized around it now. He's got a new identity. He's no longer Bill the dentist. He's Bill the guy who puts these things together. If you want something, if you have an idea, talk to Bill. If you want to get into a program, talk to Bill. New relationships. When you go and buttonhole 30, 40 people asking them if they'll present a program next year, you meet some new folks and you establish some new relationships. A renewed sense of purpose. He wants our golf community constantly striving to be the best golf community in the area. But not just a golf community, a community that involves lifelong learning. And though he couldn't care less about an enhanced sense of power, he has had a tremendous impact on our community. And now what's happened is we've hired a full-time coordinator for this. And what's Bill doing now? Well, he's out visiting other golf communities in Southwest Florida saying, hey, why don't you guys try something like this? And what's happening is that some of the offerings in some of the other communities, people are guest speaking in ours now, and some of the folks in our community who have got kind of special interests or skills or experience are going elsewhere. wonderful example of what happens in phase four. That's phase four at its very, very best, in my opinion. So, to review and wrap things up, there are four identifiable phases of retirement. You now know what they are. If you're retired, you know what phase you're in. Virtually impossible to avoid any of them, though time spent in each will vary in terms of length and in terms of intensity. Phase two clearly is the most dangerous. It's not where we want to spend a third of our lives, if we can possibly avoid it. But the truth is that sometimes people don't get to phase four. I estimate only about half of people do. Some people are in phase one. They say they're happy in phase one. I know of two people who are in phase one and are happy to stay there. They say they're happy. I think they're wrong. But there are people in phase two for sure, people who try things in phase three, nothing quite works, then they slide back into depression. Bad things can happen. But phase four is clearly the most gratifying. It's where that real sense of purpose and mission and contribution can be achieved. So it's okay to retire. It's okay to tire, but never to retire. I hope that's the message that you get from this. When you're finished learning and changing and reinventing yourself and working to stay involved, only then are you finished. And I want you to say, I'm not retired, I am rewired. That's what I hope you'll say. So, back to Lee. Everyone says you need to get ready financially. Yes, you do. But don't forget the psychological changes and challenges. 10,000 people in North America will retire today. Most of them will march blissfully towards that, not having a clue what to expect. I believe and I hope that with this framework, that you can now have a better sense of what you can expect. You can know when you're in different phases, because the tendency as often is that when we're in a phase, we think we're always going to be there. And we could be, but there are options. If forewarned is forearmed, I hope you feel that you are better forearmed than you might have been half an hour ago. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here.
Riley, I'm just wondering, do you have any suggestions for people that are stuck in phase two and how to get them catapulted into phase three so they get to phase four?
Yeah.
And even from phase three to phase four? Like,
well,
it's good information, but how do you fix it?
Yeah. Well, I guess my experience has been that there comes a time when most people, fortunately, say to themselves, I don't want to go on like this for the rest of my life. And they're the people who are more inclined to start some of the experiments in phase three. Unfortunately, those who either can't or don't get out of phase two are probably in that statistic that I told you about, the males over 75. And then in phase three, my hope is that these tools can be of some help as you do some self-analysis, because to identify some strengths and high points, I think, can help to point you in a direction. In some cases, people find their passion a brand new passion. But I will say that my experience is that about maybe 10 or 15% of people that I've interviewed had something that sustained them through their working career. That particular passion, it may have been photography, it may have been Boy Scouts, Girl Guides, something that they maintained all through their lives, their working careers, and they just kind of jumped in full bore in retirement. So they would have been that small group of people who might have been able to avoid phase two.
Any other questions at all?
Yes, ma'am. Oh, Harry wants to come.
Yeah, sorry. It's not me, it's Baxter, our awesome video guy, says make sure you get these questions on the microphones.
So your presentation was fantastic. I really, really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
It was filled. I love the interaction and how we actually got to step right into our own stuff without feeling on the spot. But my question is, are you seeing a translation from what you're really good at during your working life into becoming some a part of what is stage three. So if you like to be a mentor and a leader and you had a leadership role and you're really good at encouraging mm-hmm. people and developing people and being their champion, are you seeing a connection between that when they get into phase three and they're saying, I was good at that in work.
Yes.
How do I take that into
exactly.
you know, my personal retirement picture?
Yeah, that was exactly, I mean, that's part of the background and part of the rationale for asking you to look at your unique ability and some of the high points, because people often overlook some of the strengths that they had that helped them to be successful during their working career. And I would say I'm just going to pull a number, but I would say that most people end up doing something in phase four that was a result of a strength or an experience that they would have had previously. It's unusual for the lady that I just described who didn't have a musical note in her body to decide to pick up a music. That's the unusual thing. What you describe is much more common.
Yeah. So easier for us to find.
Yes, yes. I asked the question whether you are in a position currently to say in one sentence or so what your unique ability is. Most people are not. It's powerful to be able to do that. Second question would be, are you in a position of being able to identify your life's purpose in one sentence? Most people aren't, because they haven't put the time into this kind of thing, but it's powerful to be able to do it. So the reason I'm here, in my opinion, my purpose in being here is to make a positive difference in the lives of others through education. That's what I try to do with my Probus work and my Water Ambassadors work and my writing and this sort of stuff. So it can really focus. When you know that, it's powerful stuff. Yeah.
Any other questions, Noel?
Do you define retirement as the end of work for pay?
And I think that's probably about the best way that I can put it. Although, I mean, lots of people, I mean, a lot of what I do is for pay, but I'm funneling it back into my causes. So I'm not sure how to define it even anymore. Harry, you'd like the microphone again.
I am self-employed, so I work for everybody, not a single employer.
Exactly.
And so I'm trying to define retirement for mm-hmm. myself.
Yeah.
Try and put this this program into perspective for me.
Right. Well, lots of people are hugely passionate about what they do, their calling, their profession, their job. And so I would say carry on. I mean, if you love what you're doing, carry on, maybe at a reduced level of intensity or maybe with some more time for yourself, but why stop if you love it? But I think it's fair to say that the vast majority of people look forward to retirement, to that period of time when they don't have to do what they've done for 40 years. You're in a unique situation. Probably the people who, in my experience in this research, are least susceptible to phase two are people like yourselves, people who control your own time, people who are not forced to step away from something that you may have loved. You're able to kind of wind it down if you like. The only other, I'll leave it at that. Yeah.
Any other questions at all?
Well, just a comment, kind of back to what Graham was asking. So this is the second time I think I've seen this and was introduced to it by Harry probably about a year ago. Mm. So I'm not in retirement and not close to being in retirement, but just to be introduced to this now, I found myself on some level already processing and working and doing few things in phase one, a few things in phase three, just because I'm aware of this, mm-hmm. to
as per your last answer, hopefully eventually just gradually go through 1, 3, into 4, slow down work and just get a jump on things.
The idea, the hope in writing the book was that for people who are not retired, that it would provide them that kind of heads up. Because if we can see a framework or a context, it always makes us, it makes it easier for us, I think. And that was sort of the intent of our of the 99 game, that when you can look at things within a context, it makes it easier. And I appreciate that comment. Thank you. Chen.
More of a comment than a question. What I've noticed in the community that I'm in is that the men particularly struggle more than the women. The women have the social networks.
Yes.
And what the guys around me are doing is trying to find ways to structure their time, and they're missing the passion part. So I've asked them the question, don't look for what you can do, look for what you can create. It's a different question, but then you get a different answer.
It is.
So for me, what I did was, I noticed we have a bunch of golfers in our community, and I used to put on sports psych seminars for runners and triathletes. Ah. So now I'm putting on, this Monday coming, a sports psych seminar for golfers. So
perfect.
I created that.
Perfect.
And our little community, much like your iLife guy, most of the events were around social and food. Mm-hmm. And I said, there's nothing for the mind. So now we put on TED Talks once a month and use them as a platform for discussion.
Good.
That's
for
what
you.
We do there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's part of my transition because I didn't like staying in two for too long. So I'm somewhere in three.
That's okay. As long as you're not in two, that's good. That's great.
I'm just going to wrap up with two quick comments. Number one, and it was said, John, my son is 30 years old, Justin. He sat through the workshop. He said, this is for everybody. This is tremendous information that really we can all benefit from immediately. And secondly, and I've noticed this in the 35 years that I've had a front row seat watching people, one of the toughest things that we do in life is ask the question, why? You get 1,000% return out of planning. We're so busy with life. We're so busy with all the things going on around us. We often don't step back and look in the mirror and say, where do I want to go? And most importantly, why? That requires drilling down and getting to the things that Riley was talking about is what's our passion? What's important? Why are we here? And how can we make a difference? Because I think most of us, like a wave, we want to have an impact that goes well beyond when we're physically left from this earth. And we do that by investing and try to make the people around us in the world a little bit of a better place. And when you have that passion, when you connect with that, it makes getting up every morning pretty special. So again, on behalf of the Harry James Group, thank you for sponsoring. Riley, thank you so much for coming out today. Outstanding job. And for all of you for investing your time. The most precious asset we have in life is time, and you took a couple hours. And I know you're going to get a great return on it, but we do want to thank you for taking that time and spending it with us today. There's sandwiches here to my right. Please come up and have another one before you go, and feel free to hang out. And again, Riley would be more than happy to sign your book. So thank you so much, everybody.
Yeah, thank you, folks.